Well, welcome back to the podcast, Conversations with Jeff Bucknam. Dr. Jeff Bucknam is the lead pastor of Teaching and Vision at Harvest Bible Chapel in Chicagoland. I'm your host, co-host, Tommy Creutz, and we're going to have a conversation with someone today because we believe that everyone has a story. But before we get into that conversation, we're going to have a little preamble, where we talk about whatever it is that we want to talk about today. The last couple of weeks, Jeff, we've been hitting some pretty heavy topics. You know, I think first we were talking about what happened over the summer.
Yeah. The people need to know.
Yeah.
My favorite was the fact that we covered, I think, in great detail, the election. Yeah. I don't think you need any other election coverage.
No, that's probably, feels like that's it.
Yeah.
That's all there needs to be.
Yep.
You should not.
I heard this week though that there one of the candidates is having Harris.
Yeah,
She's having meetings about who gets to interview her first. So
okay. What network? What news network?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
When I heard that, I thought I hate meetings generally, but that would be a meeting that I don't think I could attend. That would be the worst meeting ever.
Yeah.
Wouldn't it? Hey, we're going to get together, and for the next, hours, we're going to talk about which one of the network whatevers is going to get to interview us.
Yeah.
So we'll go through their bios and blah, blah, blah. Oh, my word.
That sounds like such a... Oh, man. I bet you...
Can you imagine?
I would barely be able to keep my eyes closed.
Can you imagine doing this for your living?
No.
To trying to figure out what everybody thinks about everything you might say or not say, or whether or not you should wear this outfit.
What, you don't do that? You don't do that?
No, it's on. Wow. No, you know what? Before I preach, I think I've said before, I just asked my wife, do I look stupid? And she usually says, no. Well, she'll say, no, you look fine. Or she won't say no. She'll just go,
and that's when you know.
No, you're fine. Okay. That pause right there.
You change your clothes when she does that?
Well, she has. I have to.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's good.
The problem is she doesn't give a lot of guidance. So yeah. I changed my clothes into other stuff, but then it's still, the pause is still there.
Yeah. So did she buy your clothes for you?
She gave it. She's not interested in buying clothes for me. She's not a real shopper, my wife. She doesn't like going out and shopping all the time or anything like that. She gets really sick of it. You know what's so great is that I think she's kind of come around to Amazon.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
You got packages showing up at the door every...
Yeah, but not really that much. My point is that she'd rather just look at something on Amazon than go to the mall, which is, yeah. I talked to a friend and he's like, oh, I'm trying to get my wife to that point because he just can't handle the mall.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The malls, I have a very mixed feeling about the mall because we live close to one, right? Or all of us. You know, probably, hopefully everyone who's...
You live close to a mall?
Well, Woodfield, relatively close. Well, you know.
No, you don't. You live an hour away from
So that's true. It's an hour away. And so it makes returning things pretty difficult. The great thing is that Kelly's mom lives really super close to the mall.
So the kids can be looked after.
So they can be looked after while you go
to the mall.
Yeah. Or Kelly. I don't usually go.
Why wouldn't you go to the mall?
I don't love it.
When you were dating her, did you go to the mall?
Of course I did. Yeah. I wanted to, mostly because I was trying to impress her.
Yeah, I was going to say, for all the six women who listen to this show, can we just let you in a little piece of it?
You think six? That's generous.
So I'm just telling you that this is something that most young women don't know, and that is that he's not going to the mall after you get married.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's one of the first things to fall away.
Yeah, I was like, I could listen. You want an Auntie May's? Isn't that the name of it? The
Auntie May?
What's the name of it? Auntie Anne's.
We should start a competitor.
Auntie May.
Auntie May.
Is there another one that has May in it?
I don't know.
Fannie Mae? Okay, yeah.
No, wait,
the chocolate. Now okay, getting, see?
No. See, Fannie Mae is not a chocolate. Isn't that the name of a mortgage brokerage?
Hey, here we are.
Anyway,
I've for sure have bought
the pretzels, yeah. Though I know what you're talking about. Auntie Anne's pretzels.
That's right, the pretzels. Yeah. Hey, I could, I showed her. I was like, I I'll walk around the mall with you and buy you delicious treats.
And then...
And now I just see, well, I think it's, here's what I think is, I think partly is because I don't enjoy it. And I think also partly is she doesn't like shopping with me anyway. Mm-hmm. Right? So it's a bit of a mutual.
Yeah. My wife doesn't like shopping with me either. Yeah.
I think I'm too practical for.
Oh, I just.
I'll be incredibly outlandish. Oh. Like I'll walk into Z Art Gallery, which used to be a shop there at Woodfield. And there was this like amazing. It was called the Cloud Couch and it had like compartments and it was so comfortable. And I'm like, this is the one that we have to save up for and get. And she's like, never.
Why wouldn't you?
In a million years, will this be in our home? But I, every time we went to the mall, I looked at the cloud and I said, someday, babe, that's, you want to go in and sit on it again?
Dreams, honey.
The dreams.
Yeah.
And then that place closed down and I've never seen it again. And
I wonder if they have any of those cloud couches just kind of sitting around then.
They probably should because it was amazing. Right. And so that's probably why I don't get invited.
Yeah, I'm not a fan of the, I just, yeah. If you asked me, you want to go to the mall, I'd feel like, oh,
yeah,
that would be the, well, like one of the last things I'd want to do.
I feel like it's even harder for us now that we're on a diet. All the mall food is like.
We're on a diet?
Well, yeah, you're on a diet. I'm on a diet.
My diet is not to die.
Yeah. Mine's.
Do you have a not to die diet now?
I think it's like help to prevent. I have high triglycerides.
So you're eating different now?
I'm eating different.
Wow.
Yeah. You didn't know. Well, yeah, no.
I kind of knew that, I think, but I didn't realize that you were.
I've moved mostly, I would say probably from all processed foods is what was what I ate before. Just everything is processed as we can
what
get it.
What did you miss the most?
Bread.
You don't eat bread?
No. Well, no. I haven't had bread in 4 weeks.
All right.
Do you
eat rice?
Do you remember when we were eating small Cheval together? I took the bread. Delicious morsels.
We were at a meeting and someone provided small Cheval. And I'm not allowed to eat that either. But
we both were a little naughty that day.
I did eat it.
But yeah, no. I feel like, what's the point of going to the mall? We can't have the anti-ants, the anti-maze. We can't have whatever that other place is that smells and looks delicious.
It's Mrs. Fields, by the way.
What's that?
Isn't that the cookie place?
Cookie?
Yeah.
Crumble Cookie also. Yeah. The whole food court that they created. Have you seen the stuff in there? Stands, donuts, and
see, you're right. The other places. No, all the stuff you can't have.
It's all bad.
No, it is. Yeah,
it's all processed. Cinnabon. Yeah, Cinnabon. That's the other one I was thinking of. Oh, my goodness. What I would do right now for those delicious carbs. I love them so much. Oh.
So is this is for the rest of your life kind of diet?
I'm trying, So I think the people know. I wrestled my whole life. So used to cut... Everything. I used to cut weight like a wrestler, which is incredibly unhealthy, and just starve yourself until you drop all the weight. And every time it would come back and come back. So this time I'm taking...
Shocking.
Yeah, shocking how that...
You know, start eating again and it comes right back.
I didn't change anything. So now I'm trying to over a significant like 6 month period, like change eating habits and working out and try to get those numbers down. This is why I didn't go to the doctor before. You know, if you never go to the doctor, you can never get a bad test result. You know what I'm saying?
It's true.
So I finally go after like 8 years and they're like, hey, your triglycerides are out of this world.
Okay. So, do you know what a triglyceride is right now?
I have no idea what it is. He just said it's bad. And you... Instead of going on medication, you can diet and work out. So that's what I'm doing.
As he just took a swig of a Coke Zero.
What's that say?
It says zero on it.
There's no triglycerides in this puppy. I don't think, unless someone, if you know what a triglyceride is.
Can I ask you, just do me a favor?
Yeah.
Because I have very few joys in this life.
Yeah.
And drinking... like Coke Zero or Diet Mountain Dew or Mountain Dew Zero, is one of the very few.
The simple
and the
joys.
Moment you start talking to people about it, they're like, "Well, you're trying to be healthier, huh?" And you're like, "Yeah, I'm trying to be healthier." Yeah. Are you drinking Coke Zero still? And I'll say yes, and then they'll just Yeah. They'll just unload on me with a bunch of information that they got from Twitter
about that, aspartame.
Yeah. They have no scientific background at all. Wow. They're ridiculous.
Wow.
They're ridiculous. Why? Oh, it'll kill you. I know. And then they give me some story about some guy who's, you know, they knew whatever.
He had sip of aspartame.
Well, you know what? I know a guy.
And his ears fell off.
I know a guy who had a lot of aspartame and became Superman. So there you go.
Hey. Yeah.
Who's to say aspartame doesn't actually make you live longer? That's what I'm asking.
Yeah. We should fund some sort of research.
No kidding.
Is there aspartame in that?
Yeah. And guess what?
Because there isn't here.
If I funded the research, I probably would get the result I want, which is exactly
all that. Conspiracy.
We talk about conspiracies. There's an anti-aspartame conspiracy in this world.
There's a big sugar. It's big sugar. They're out there and they're trying to take down. Man, I'm in on that. Man, that's it. Big sugar.
See?
Big sugar. Trying to.
Speaking of big sugar. I'm going to have a good conversation with.
A big piece of sugar. Yeah. Well, I don't. All right.
Yeah.
You're going to have a conversation with Moses, who is a worship leader and part of the ministry team here at Rolling Meadows. And you guys are going to have a conversation and because he has a story, and you guys are going to get into his right now. Let's go.
I'm here with Chun Moses.
Yes.
Is that right?
Moses Chun. Technically Chun Moses in Korean.
I know.
Yeah.
I'm trying to speak your language,
thank you,
brother.
Thank you. It's actually pronounced Jun.
Jun.
Like J-U-N.
Is the C-H sound always?
No, so.
That sound?
So the quick story behind it is my dad has five brothers and.
It sounds like a story someone told Jesus once.
Yeah, probably. But basically his oldest. He's number two out of five. His oldest brother went to study at Northwestern. So when he immigrated, he put his last name as C-H-E-O-N, Chun. And then he told all the other brothers, hey, if you're going to immigrate here, let's like not be related.
Whoa.
Or like not, like let's not be like sketchy maybe. And like, just if we get caught, then we're going to all get caught. Basically, that's what in his mind.
Yeah, okay.
And so my dad he's like, okay, I'm going to put C-H-U-N. And then the other brothers are like, that's kind of dumb. So they all became J-U-N, which is the actual spelling it should be. So
when you go and you meet your uncles, mm-hmm. your uncles have different last names.
Yeah.
Than what you have.
Yeah. Well,
do you come from a Korean crime family?
Basically, no.
Like why are you worried
about? I don't know, maybe they're afraid back in the 80s when they're immigrating here or 90s. Okay. I don't know, you can ask my dad, but you'll probably get a Korean answer.
What does that mean?
Because he doesn't speak English.
Really?
Not well.
Really?
Yeah.
At home then, when you were growing up?
Yeah, it was Korean.
You spoke Korean?
Yeah.
The whole, like, no English at all, so you learned your English in school.
Mm-hmm. Yep. And I grew up with my grandparents too. So that was even more. I spoke in Korean.
So how often would you speak in Korean today?
Not much.
Really? So how many days would go by before you'd speak Korean?
Well, my dad calls me like every other day. So okay. I do talk to him in Korean.
Okay.
But that's like 5-minute combos.
Right. But you're dreaming in English now and you're thinking in English.
Most of the time. Yeah.
Okay.
But I still watch like Korean shows and stuff like that. Sometimes.
Do you?
Yeah.
Squid Game?
Maybe. I don't have Netflix.
Is Squid Game the most famous Korean show ever?
Probably. Yeah.
Okay.
I think so.
Yeah. I saw one episode of it.
Yeah. I watched all of it.
Did you? Did you like it?
Yeah. I enjoyed it. It was kind of gory, but it was fun. Good storyline.
Yeah.
Yeah. A lot of Korean dramas will do that for you. Like, they'll hook you.
Will they?
Uh-huh.
Good storytelling.
Oh, then. Yeah.
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 All right.
Kind of cheesy sometimes.
Would you like to, like, if you sat down, you were going to watch any kind of show. You would much rather watch Korean television than you would like watching like
by myself?
English language.
Yeah. By myself. Yeah.
Or probably. American, or would you watch British? No.
No.
Why not? You don't like the British?
I mean, I like British people and soccer.
Just not their humor.
Yeah, maybe. Well, I watched Ted Lasso, but that doesn't, that's not really British. Yeah. So I'm trying to be relevant, but.
Okay. Well, this is where, like, I'm assuming you got the name Moses though, because you have a Christian family.
Yeah. So my dad's a pastor. He started a Korean church here in Chicagoland, Chicago actually, when I was one.
When did he, so you moved here, were you born in the States or were you born in?
So, I'm the youngest of four.
Okay.
My parents and my family immigrated when she was 3 months pregnant with me.
Oh.
Yeah. So.
So you just have Korean heritage.
I'm American born.
Yeah, American born.
I could be president.
I mean, everybody. That's the beauty of America is no matter how you got here, you're here, and as a result, you're American, right?
Yep.
But you were born in the United States, so you can be president of the United States.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
You know what? I've been told it's not that hard to become president of the United States.
You're not wrong. Great name for a president, though, Moses, you know.
Yeah.
I split both parties.
You would.
Somehow.
So you grew up in Chicago or Chicagoland?
Chicago, actually. When I was born in, I think, the south side of Chicago.
Okay.
And then we moved pretty quickly to the north side of Chicago.
So when you say north side of Chicago,
well, like where Albany Park, Jefferson Park type area.
Okay.
It's like the north side of Chicago. I think I'm pretty sure I was born on the south side.
Okay.
Where there was a lot of crime happening. Because that's kind of, I think, where his brother landed. Mm. And so we kind of.
So when they came over.
Yeah.
And his brother, your dad's brother, when he came to the States, he came to Chicago.
Yeah. He studied at Northwestern.
Okay.
He was a music major. Yeah. He was actually very great at what he did. And I think he was the first Asian main character of Phantom of the Opera.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
Good for him.
Yeah. In Chicago. So.
That's fantastic.
Yep. That. And then my dad came in 92 in August.
Okay.
I'm pretty sure. Yep.
And you were born in 1993?
In January.
Okay.
Yep. And then he started a church in 1994. So we just passed 30 years this year with my dad.
What is the name of the church your dad started?
It's called Jeseurun Presbyterian Church. In Korean, it's Yosurun Changnoge. Yeah.
Okay.
So, yeah.
Presbyterian is a big denomination in Korea.
Yes,
it is. South Korea, mm-hmm. as I recall.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's huge.
One of like the biggest.
Yeah. That and probably the full gospel, which is more Pentecostal.
Yeah. That's David Cho's one, isn't mm-hmm. he? Yeah.
Youngi Cho.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. So grew up in a Presbyterian family.
Yeah. So my grandpa was also a pastor in Korea. He has a pretty wild story of how he actually did that. If you want me to explain, I can do that. Okay. So he was born in World War I times. So back in Korea, Japan captured Korea. So they're under Japanese rule.
Yep.
And basically my grandpa.
Which I had some Korean friends when I was in high school, and they said that has some significant lasting effects.
It does.
On the way that Koreans and Japanese interact with one another.
Yeah.
Even today.
Yeah. So they respect each other, but they really don't like each other.
Yeah.
Like you go to, well, and even like soccer games or whatever, it's like the heightened rivalry.
Yeah. 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 Which I always thought was interesting because they shared the World Cup, you know, Korea, Japan.
Yeah.
Back in, what is it, 2002 or whatever it was. But the, I remember having that. And I had a friend who I used to play tennis with, who was Japanese, and
they don't like the Koreans.
Well, he had this really odd view of Koreans. Like he almost, I don't even know how to say that. Like look down his nose at them type thing. Like they're less than us type thing.
Yeah.
Which I'm not saying is the case for every Japanese person by any means, but I remember asking him like, why, like, what is that? What's going on there?
Yeah. So I think that played a big part of it. And so my grandpa was a part of the military. Like you had to basically be, but he was part of the Japanese.
When you say have to be, is everybody?
Well, now even I was telling someone earlier today, it's like every male has to go to the army.
Yeah.
Like that's, you have to do your duties.
If you are a citizen
of Korea.
Of Korea.
Yeah. Every male, unless you get exempt, which very few people do.
Right.
Athletes, if they medal in any event.
That's your reward.
No, for real. So if you look, I think it was like the 2012 Olympics, that Korea got third or something like that. And you can see the players like running for joy all around the field because they're like, we don't have to go to the milk. They have to go like, but it's like a 1 month deal rather than like 2.5 years.
Okay.
So anyway, and basically they didn't like Koreans. And so they basically beat him to death like every day. And so for 2 years, like basically his whole spine, they like destroyed his whole spine. And so he was basically, he couldn't move. He couldn't get up. So he was like basically laying down for 2 years. And his friends, or, and I think he was like to his friends, like, hey, just put me up in the mountain. Like, let me just die there. And so the friends just took him up to the mountains to let him just, you know, die, because that's what his wish was. And basically, but he was still alive. Like his mind, everything was still alive, but he just, everything was broken. And it became nighttime and it got cold. And this is a true story. So it does, it might sound fake, but it, this is true. He said it's cold. And he, I think his dad was an elder of a church. So they were believing Christians. He said, God, if you're real, like I'm cold right now. I need like, if you can give me warmth, that'd be awesome. And so he, no joke, but he said like a mountain lion came and hugged him like during, at night, every night to give him warmth. And he like, cause he couldn't move and he couldn't, you know, find warmth. So he just, and then he left when he woke up. And then during the day it was super hot and he said the same thing to God. And said, God, if you're real, like I need like some cold or whatever, or basically that. And so he said a snake coiled around him during the day and basically gave him some like coolness in his body. And then it happened frequently. And then at the end he was like, God, if you heal me, I'll be a pastor for the rest of my life. And then he just heard this voice where he says, get up and walk. And he's like, God, I'm literally, my body's broken. Like, again, he's like, get up and walk. And he stood up and actually started walking down, back down the mountain. And that's kind of where he got saved. And that's where he said, I'm going to be a pastor for the rest of my life. So growing up, how I knew it was true, his back was literally like this.
When you say this, he's making like a
greater right sign. Angle, yeah. So he was like always hunched down. And I could feel like when I hugged him, like I could feel the point where like kind of all kind of combined together. And so that's kind of where he started being a pastor. And then he would go to these, to be a pastor in the Presbyterian denomination, you have to go through seminary.
Yeah.
There's a long ordination process for it. But I don't know why back at the time he tried to get into seminary and they said, hey, you are disabled and you're not qualified to preach the gospel. And so they didn't let him in. But he knew that God saved him and, you know, and God called me to this. And so I'm going to dedicate my life. So he would go to these small rural towns, farming towns, and would just gather people, you know, have church, and then it would grow to a few hundred. And then the denomination would come and kick him out, basically.
And put somebody else in.
Yeah, because they're like, hey, you're not qualified. Mm. And so, and then he'd go to another town. That's same
pretty
thing.
Effective church planting.
Yeah, strategy. Same thing. And then eventually the denomination's like, okay, we'll let you into seminary. But then the professors would actually fail him because they didn't see him qualified to preach the gospel. And then eventually when he kept on doing and being really effective in ministry, they're like, okay, we can't stop you. And so that's how he kind of got started. And so,
and your dad followed in his footsteps.
He didn't want to, but he felt called from God and to do it. So my dad, the big reason why he came over to Chicago specifically is that my grandpa on his sabbatical year came to Chicago to be with family, his oldest son, but he actually started a church in his time in his sabbatical. Which is called Just Room Presbyterian Church.
Yeah, this church.
And he handed it off when he left, and then it all shut down because it didn't last. And so he always had a heart for Chicago. My grandpa did, and so he sent my dad out to start the church in Chicago to restart it.
And that's how you got here.
And that's how I got here. So that's a long story.
Growing up in Chicago then,
yeah.
You were in the You were born in 94?
93.
93.
Yep.
I got married in 93, son.
That's great.
It is great.
Great year.
It was a good year,
yep.
As I recall.
So
that's ridiculous. Sorry, I'm just feeling my age right here for a second.
Moses, I'll let you feel.
That's just not right. Because you're wearing, you're wearing a Chicago Bulls six-time champion retro shirt right now, which is not, it's funny.
You live this.
I did.
Yeah.
I did. I remember.
And I remember. Was born for it.
I'm more connected to that than you are.
Yeah. I can give you this shirt to feel more connected.
But you you grew up in Chicago.
Yep.
And you ended up moving out to the suburbs though.
Yeah. So the church started growing and then my dad built the church in Arlington Heights.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So that was in 2000.
So the whole church moved out to Arlington Heights.
Yeah. A lot of them were, the Chicago Koreatown was like in kind of where we were, the northern part of Chicago. And then it started growing and fanning out to like Niles and that area, Skokie. And so he kind of, then we moved out to Lake Zurich, our Killdeer area.
Yeah.
Because my grandpa retired from Korea as pastor and then came and lived with us.
Okay.
That's near
where I live.
Barrington.
Yeah, dude.
Yeah. So
we're basically like neighbors.
Yeah, you and my dad.
Yeah. I want you to give me some help with Korean culture.
Okay.
By help, I mean, if I were going to go to Korea, which by the way is one of those places in the world that I would love to go because Seoul looks amazing.
Yeah.
Right, it does.
Yeah.
So,
I've actually never been.
Well, we're going to go together then.
Okay, perfect.
What do I need to know about Korean culture?
Yeah.
Like what kinds of things are unique to Korean culture? Things that Koreans do that other people don't do? Like, will I be offensive to certain people if I do certain things? What kind of foods am I going to have to like?
Yeah.
What am I going to have to start eating? And please don't say the cabbage. I don't like it.
Yeah.
I tried the kimchi and it's just, I can't do it.
Yeah. Kimchi is one of them. But there's also, kimchi is like a very, obviously the original form is with the fermented cabbage.
Yeah.
But now there's so many variations of it.
Okay.
So like my wife, who is Caucasian, doesn't necessarily like the cabbage as well. She'll eat it, but she likes the more the radish one.
Okay.
And so that's...
I might try that.
Yeah. And so there's different variations of it. Koreans are, I mean, they're very respectful and honoring. So like for me to you...
But you're not that way toward me.
If you want me to,
You're very not Korean then toward me.
Yeah, I am not.
Yeah.
But if I would probably bow to you to say hello, and depending on the level of,
I'm pretty high.
I'm
pretty
respect.
High.
You would know by the
Dr.
angle,
Bucknam.
Dr. Bucknam.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. By the angle of my bow.
Moses, you're going to have to get down pretty low.
I will do 90 degrees to you. That's like kind of an ultimate level of respect.
Really though? So bowing.
Yeah. So like if you're like.
How do you know how much to bow to a particular person? It's just your feeling regarding how much they are?
Mm-hmm.
Can I offend somebody if I don't bow like far enough down?
I think they'll give you a lot of grace because they know you're not Korean.
Right. But if you didn't bow far enough down to somebody who thought they deserved more of a bow.
No, they're not like that stingy.
Okay.
But like if you just did it like half-heartedly, I think they would probably say something.
Okay.
Like if I just did a head nod or something and they're like, "Hey, what are you?"
Yeah.
Yeah, you know, they might say something.
Okay.
So
when you see is that something you do with your parents or your dad or?
Yeah. Not as much anymore, but my wife does.
Okay.
Actually. And we're teaching my child that as well.
Okay.
It's called insa, which is like bow. And greeting. And so he did it yesterday. It was awesome. But then holidays are somewhat big. Oh, New Year's is like a big holiday.
Okay.
We kind of celebrate Chinese New Year, Lunar New Year. And so we would go over to my parents' house, which my grandma still lives there. And so we'd go and...
Do people in Korea travel like they do in China for that?
Yeah.
Because like in China, it's like the biggest travel day in the world.
Uh-huh. So you would go and to the most elderly person in your family.
Mm.
And then you would have like a full meal. Like you'll have this, one of my favorite meals is this rice cake soup. And it's like rice cake that's like a little bit chewier and it's really good. And it's like with this great broth and lot of little toppings here and there. But the sign is like when you eat that, you grow a year older. Mm. And so we have that. And then we also do we bow fully down, all the way down, like on our knees and with our head bowed to all of our elders.
Oh, wow.
And we'll say like, 새해 복 많이 받으세요, which means hope you receive a lot of blessings this year.
That's just for that day.
That day. And then they'll give us an envelope filled with money.
Okay.
Which is great for the young. We don't
get
it
anymore. Though that's a thing though, that's expected if you're an older person.
Yeah, we give it to the
bow down.
The
kids. Is it just your family?
Yeah. Like mostly my family, but then there'll be people because there's people from our church. Like my dad was pastor, respected my grandpa or my grandma, they'll come by on that day too with gifts and different things like that. And they'll bow and they'll say the same thing, but they won't give them money.
Okay.
But,
yeah. But just the money's for the family though.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. So, or I mean they could, but.
What other holidays do you celebrate? Obviously, I mean, I'm assuming Christmas.
That was the big one. There's like a, Christmas, personally for me as a family, we didn't really celebrate as much. We didn't grow up with a lot of money.
Yeah.
And it was like church day for us. Yeah. So we had church on Christmas day.
Yep.
And my dad obviously preaching or leading that service. And so we didn't really do,
but it wasn't quite the kind of thing that America,
some
the
families,
Americana might. Christmas day where the tree and the gifts and the,
some families might. So I don't want to speak for
sure,
everyone,
but your family, not so much.
Not family. Yeah. But like,
but it wasn't part of your cultural history though.
Yeah.
So
not as much.
Coming to the States, it would have been a different kind of vibe.
Especially the Korean Christians, we went to church. That's what we did, you know? So, but
why are there are so many Christians in Korea?
Yeah.
Like it is one of the per capita largest Christian nations in the world.
Yeah. I think post Korean War, I think there was a lot of desperation and longing for something, right? Mm-hmm. And I think it was a good timing for, I think, the American missionaries that came in to preach the gospel. And it kind of started this whole wave of revival of, because they were very respectful to their elders.
Yeah.
And so, it kind of, Jesus and serving Jesus was kind of like made sense, you know, instead of, I mean, although there's a lot of Christians there, Buddhism is very big. Big there and different things like serving a master or different things like that, a god. Christianity, I mean, because they came in, missionaries came in, I think it spread like wildfire.
Right.
And Koreans, like, it's when something catches it spreads pretty fast. Yeah. So
when you were growing up, did you spend most of your time with the Korean community?
Yeah. So that's why I say my dad maybe doesn't speak English as much.
Right,
He didn't have to, And so he spoke, I mean, it was Korean church most of the time, and a lot of early morning prayers, because they love that. My dad still wakes up at 4:30 and goes to church and leads early morning prayer here. And I went to some of those, not all of those. I was sleeping in. We did church on Sunday. Our whole day was church.
Yeah. So when you say your whole day was church,
I mean,
how long would a service be with if I came to your dad's church?
It wouldn't be like that long. It'd probably be like an hour and a half or 15.
So okay.
Yeah. He was serving a lot of immigrants and they're working Monday through Saturday. So Sunday's kind of their whole day that you have.
Right. So you'd have the service, but then people stick around.
Well, and then Korean churches, you should provide a meal.
Yeah.
And so we all ate together. And then for me, it was like, obviously my dad at early morning prayer, I would lead worship at the English ministry service that we'd have when that was a thing there. And then I'd play bass at the Korean service.
So why would they do an English ministry service? Is because the kids were around. They wanted to make sure the kids were part of it.
Yeah.
And
so the kids, because they couldn't understand the Korean
language.
And so they wanted to have a space for that. And so that was the 9 o'clock service, the Korean English service, and then the 11 was the Korean service, and I would play bass there, and then we'd eat together. And then there's usually like a Korean college ministry service, because there's a few colleges that people came to study for, and then I'd be there, and then we'd usually like during the summers go play soccer together, and then we'd play soccer and then come back to church and eat dinner, and then we'd go home.
Did you end up playing soccer for your school?
No, I just played it at church. I wasn't that good. I just
well, most Korean soccer players aren't very good, are they?
There's few,
right?
That are good.
You know what I mean? Like the best of them in the world play for the worst possible teams in the world, don't you think?
Maybe.
Yeah,
but I think they're
now. He knows what I'm saying because I found out the other day that my friend Moses is a fan of the worst English Premier League team in the world.
The worst team ever.
Well, do they win anything?
No.
No. Okay, so that's by definition. Yeah. They lose every year. They're called Tottenham Hotspur.
Yep.
And they built a stadium recently that looks
awesome.
Remarkably like a toilet bowl. And there's a huge at the edge of the toilet bowl, they put a little chicken on top of a ball. That's their little moniker.
Yeah.
So if you want to know a Tottenham Hotspur fan, they're the ones that have a chicken on top of a ball.
Yep.
And they put this chicken on top of the ball on the edge of the toilet bowl. So it's like a giant toilet duck.
Yeah, you're not wrong.
Yeah. But admittedly, they are the rival to Arsenal, but it's not really a rivalry because Arsenal is so much better and has so much more history than them. It's not even funny.
Yeah.
But, okay, you can cheer for this team. But the only reason you cheer for the team is because there is a Korean player who admittedly is very good.
Yep. And he's been there for basically almost 10 years now.
Yeah, he has.
So... It's very hard to make it in the
and he's the reason that you cheer for this horrible team.
I do. If he went to another team, I'd probably cheer for that team, actually.
Well, I'm going to cheer for that because I think it probably happens soon. He's getting kind of old.
He is kind of getting kind of old. But, yeah.
So you spent almost all your time then with your Korean community. Did you, at school though, you were in public school?
Yeah, I was in public school.
What high school did you go to?
Went to Lake Zurich High School.
Okay.
Yeah. And then...
What did you do? Like, was almost all your time spent... Like,
mostly at the church.
Studying and stuff, but then the rest of the time was spent at the church.
Yeah, most of the time. Okay. Like, I mean, we had church on midweek services at, like, I think Wednesday night service at, like, starting at 8 p.m. or something like that. Because, like, people would get off work late and then they'd come.
You'd always be playing music.
Yeah, I would.
Is that because it's in your family? You said that your uncle was...
Yeah, musical.
Good at music, yeah.
Yeah. It probably started when I was in middle school. Kind of in my faith journey, there's like a lot of chapters, but I remember like growing up, I felt like I had a lot of different faces. So like to my parents, I was a certain person just to please them. I was a people pleaser. So like at school, I was a different person. Mm. At church, I was a different person because I wanted my parents' reputation to be good. You know, I just had a lot of different people pleasing attributes. And I remember in, I think it was like sixth grade or something like that, I went to a conference that my dad's denomination hosted at Wheaton. And I was just kind of sick and tired of not knowing or not being me. And I didn't even know what that meant, but I was just like, I don't want to live for other people's approval. And so I just closed my eyes and I just was like, God, I need something to focus and to give my life to for you. And I opened my eyes and the worship leader was playing bass and singing. And you just kind of didn't see that.
Mm-mm.
You still don't see that, actually. And I just was like, God, if like, I want that, like, if you can help me do that, like, you know. And so it kind of started a whole, like, I did piano lessons growing up, but nothing really came of it. But then that's kind of where I started playing bass. I went up to our church bassist and was like, hey, can you teach me how to play bass? Which is a big deal for me because I was a super shy kid and didn't ask.
You were?
I was, yeah. Very, very shy. Like, I was scratching the walls.
You do not seem like a shy kid to me.
Thanks. Yeah. Well.
When did that shift?
So, that was the start of it. And then, that's kind of how I learned bass. And then when I went off to college, I think it kind of shifted.
What college you go to?
I went to Baylor.
Baylor.
Baylor. Waco, Texas.
Why?
So that's a whole story in itself.
Okay,
so I wanted to go to University of Illinois. All my siblings, I'm the youngest of four, like I said, went to University of Illinois. I grew up, like my sisters are way older. I mean, they're 11 and 10 years apart. So like growing up, dropping them off, it was like, this is college. Yeah. Like this is where I want to go.
Yeah.
And so I went, I didn't make like the best grades in high school, but I still had this hope of like, well, all my siblings went, so I'm bound to go here. I'm destined to go here. And I didn't get in.
Is Illinois hard to get? I don't even know. Is Illinois a hard school
There's some majors that are really hard.
Okay.
Like the engineering school is like one of the best.
Okay.
And there's
is other, that what you wanted to do?
No, I just wanted to just go there.
Just want to go.
But I still didn't get in, so I probably wasn't. I wasn't the greatest of students. And my mom, so she comes from a Buddhist family, got saved in college at like the one of the first weeks. She went to a camp. Someone invited her to a Campus Crusade for Christ event.
Right.
And she just felt, she was like, I don't know what this is, but I need to have this. And so she gave her life to Jesus in college, and it kind of changed the whole trajectory of her life. And, and her family almost basically disowned her for a good chunk of post that, because they were so heavily involved in the Buddhist community. And she, I remember she sat me down and said, hey, you've been wanting to go, you've been telling God where you want to go to college, but I know the next 4 years of your life can be life-changing, but and you need to ask God where he wants you to go. And I was like, okay, I don't know what that means, but I'm going to start praying. And I just prayed, God, let your will be done. And I applied to Baylor because I had an email from them saying like, hey, we'll waive your application fee or whatever. I said, sure.
You're like, $50. Yeah, oh, awesome. Cool.
I saved $50 here, you know. So I applied, got in. Didn't think much of it, honestly, because I wanted to go to University of Illinois and trying like other ways, avenues to try to get in. And I remember I came out from a Wednesday night prayer meeting, and I saw the guy who taught me how to play bass. He came back from University of Illinois for the summer, and he just asked me like what I wanted to do with my life. And I said, I don't know, but I love the church. I love serving the church. And all he said was, you need to get out of your comfort zone. And it was down to a college in Michigan and Ed Baylor at the time. And my dad,
Texas felt like out of the comfort zone.
Yeah. And well, and then the next day my dad's like, you should go to, it was Calvin College in Michigan. You should go to Calvin College because, our family friend is going to be a professor there.
Oh
like,
yeah.
They're going to have family there. It's close to home, home away from home. It'll be great for you. And then something in me was like, I'm going to go to Baylor.
I'm doing exactly the opposite.
Exactly. I need to get out of my comfort zone. And so, I went to Baylor. And it was way out of my comfort zone. Didn't like it at all.
Why not?
I think it was like a
Waco, Texas,
yeah,
man.
Yeah. I think, I mean, if you've ever been to the South, it's a whole culture.
Yeah.
It's a whole different culture down there. And I thoroughly enjoyed my church experience with my dad's church that I thought like, this is what church is, and kind of had a pride of like, didn't let other views of church or whatnot like, I was just like, this is it, you know, this is how it should be. And so I had a little bit of pride there too. But yeah, so I went to Baylor and very lonely. Like I couldn't like just drive home for the weekend because it was like 17 hours away, you know? So I was just kind of it's super lonely. Didn't have much friends, like didn't get plugged into a church because
I was going to say, did you like, when you went there, did you just sign up to live in the dorm?
And
they plopped you in with somebody,
random guy, yeah. And then he left after first semester and then some other random dude came in and then didn't get plugged into a church or anything because I was like, this it's not like my parents' church or whatever. And so was super lonely, and I kind of blamed God a lot, honestly. I was like,
it's a hard year.
Yeah. It's a hard
year. Your first year of college.
And especially you're so far away.
Yeah.
And so I was just trying to look for ways to actually go back home for the next year. Cause I was like, this God, I don't know why you sent me here.
Yeah.
Like there's no reason why you would do this. But something in me was like, if you come back next year, I'll show you why you're here. And I was like, I don't want to spend tens of thousands of dollars like here just to see what God's will is. But I was like, okay, I'm just going to do it. And so I came back the next year, had a roommate, that I met through something. And he was part of a church, that I was like, they're very passionate about living out the word of God. Like they'll go up to people like, hey, do you know Jesus? And we'll like share the gospel. Hey, we'll like go for people that, you know, might need healing, and they'll pray for healing, and they're very bold with their faith. And I was like, that's kind of a little too wacky for me. You know, I don't want to, I'm like trying to distance myself from those people. And he was just like, hey, you should go to this conference with me. This church is hosting. And I was like, no, you guys are weird. Like, I don't want to be a part of this. And he's like, okay, cool. But something in me was like, hey, you should go. And so last minute I signed up to go. And God started just like breaking down my heart and all the walls that I built up inside towards him. And it was the last session. It was Sunday morning. And Max Okato was speaking that day. And he showed this video that he showed his church for Mother's Day. And it was about this story about these two daughters telling their story of their mom, single mom. And they were going out camping. And so I think in the car was the mom driving, the two daughters and the son, and I think someone else, maybe the grandpa or someone like that. And so she got out of the car to look for a camping spot. But I think she thought she put the car in park, but it's actually in neutral. And so the car started going down the hill or down the slope. And then the mom looks around and sees that the car's not there and sees that the car is headed straight off a cliff. And so the mom starts booking it, sprinting, and gets enough where she gets in front of the car and puts her body down, and the car slows down, and then they pull the parking brake, and they were like feet away from basically dying. And the miraculous thing is that the mom wasn't dead. She was paralyzed from the neck down, but she was still alive. And I think like I said, my grandpa was pastor, my dad was pastor. I don't feel like I was ever maybe discipled as to how to walk that relationship with him. And that's where I felt like, and I knew that Jesus died for my sin, you know, did all that. But that moment, I think, changed my life. It became from like a head knowledge to like a heart knowledge to actually,
right.
Like, and I was like, my life was headed straight off a cliff, and someone put his body down on the line for me and saved me. And I think that, like, I was like, God, I'm not going to question anything, you know, even if it looks weird or anything like that. Like, if you said it, then I'm going to go and believe it and surrender to you. And so that's kind of like my second chapter where I feel like I got saved for real that time in college. And that's...
And you went back to Baylor.
I went back to Baylor.
And why were you there when you came to the conclusion?
Well, I met God. And I started getting discipled. And I was discipled first year. I was discipled by a guy named Kyle Walker. And Sherri actually knows him from Arizona. But he was like super happy, super joyful. It almost looked fake guy. And I was like, this guy's kind of weird. You know, I met him my freshman year, and I was like, I don't know if I want to be around him. And then to find out, like, he just loves Jesus that much.
Yeah.
And I needed that. I needed that joy of my salvation. And he taught me how to live in joy in the presence of God. And so learned how to walk with him.
Yeah.
Not just Kyle, but with God, and changed the trajectory of my life, like my mom said.
Yeah.
And so college changed my life.
You met your wife where?
So we actually met the first week at Baylor. We did this like orientation group called Welcome Week.
Okay.
And we knew each other. We weren't really friends. We were in the same church, but the church was pretty big. Like, our college ministry was around like 800-900 people.
Yeah, that's a lot.
A lot of people. And then so she kind of led in her small groups. And after that moment happened, I just got plugged into the church and did whatever. So serving the worship ministry, small groups, you know, overseeing small groups. We led mission trips. It was a very missional church. So we did that. And so, but I felt like I was supposed to get out of my comfort zone again, out of Waco and, the very big church planning, network. And so the next church plant being sent out was to Austin, Texas. And so I jumped on that team, and she was going to do grad school there. So she jumped on the team to just be like a super volunteer and do grad school.
So you volunteered to go plant a church.
I never wanted to, because I knew how hard it was for my dad.
Yeah.
And then I said, God, I'm never going to do that. And you know what happens when you tell God.
Yeah.
Never.
Yeah.
And so, and I felt in my heart to do that. It was one of the hardest things, but it was the most rewarding things ever. I had to raise my own support and do all that. And, but we saw God do amazing things. And, she and I had a lot of college ministry experience. So we kind of led in a lot of different capacities together. And then, you know, when we worked together,
you get to know each other,
And then we fell in love. And
did you know?
Mm-hmm.
Was that a surprise to you?
Well, so...
Because you'd known her for quite a few years at that point.
We did. Yeah, I did.
Were you just friends for a long time? And
I think in the...
One day, the light just hit her face the right way, buddy.
I think there was a lot of cultural things for me, too, of like my parents... I knew it was maybe not... it didn't look good if I maybe married a Caucasian person.
I was going to say, is it expected among most for most Korean assumed, kids that you would marry Korean?
Yeah, it's not as much anymore, but it was. Mm-hmm. And my grandpa's very strict, and so in my dad's head, it's like he was taught like, hey, we don't mix blood, with each other, and so that was I think a block that I had, of like I have to marry a Korean, and so. And so that was a whole process. And some at one time I was just kind of like, let's just do it. Like, let's just like, what's the worst that's going to happen, you know? And so I was just like, all right, well, like I knew she liked me from what I've heard. And I was like, I started liking her.
Was that the word on the street there, Moses?
I did.
Yeah. A lot of people talking.
Yeah. And, but like, you know, my pastors were like, hey, like, She might be interested, but I know that you're looking for a Korean, and so we're not going to recommend her. I was like, okay, cool. But then at the end, I was just like, what if we just went for it and see? And so, and then again, there was a moment where, for months, where it was like my dad was pretty hardened to the idea of it. You know, we would have a great
conversation. Was it hard for the first time you brought it up?
Oh, yeah. Like
how'd you do that?
And so, I mean, I was just saying like, hey, I'm seeing this girl. She's white. And he's like, okay, cool. And then just like hung up. And then we'd have other phone conversations where we would talk. Great conversation.
And then
I would bring up
the girl
and he'd be like, okay, gotta go.
Yeah.
You can just feel
like,
there's a wall right there.
Yeah. Didn't want to talk about it.
And I just was like, and I felt like, man, I do want to marry this girl. But I also wanted her to know, like, I don't know how long this is going to take.
Yeah.
Cause Koreans are big on honor.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so I'm like, I don't want to move forward if there's no blessing on both sides here. And so even if it's, you know, maybe God's will, but maybe that's controversial, but I was just like, hey, I want both parents to bless this. And so, and she's like, I'm going to fight. We'll fight till it happens. And so, we prayed and she's awesome. And she had this whole prayer wall that she wrote down. She prayed every day, and eventually God kind of broke a lot of that in an unexpected way through my mom. But yeah, it's great.
And can I ask what that means?
So I was like kind of tired of the, like, he's just shutting down on all the, every time I brought her up, it was like, hey, we're done with this conversation. And so I was like, I'm just going to go up there and fly up there and talk to him one-on-one, just because I'm like, hey, what's up here? Like, let's get it all on the table. And so, you know, like on the plane, I'm writing down, like, if he has this question, I have
the answer. Yeah, you got the decision tree. I love it.
I have all the things, you know. And so me, my mom, and my dad, we went out to eat. And it was common for us, like, growing up, like, if he saw a church member or someone, he knew a lot of Koreans. Like, they would pay for a meal, like, because, like, they want to honor the pastor and whatnot.
Yeah, I'm waiting for that to happen.
Yeah.
Moses.
And next time I see you, I'll pay for it.
Thanks, buddy.
Pay for your meal. Great conversation. I didn't bring it up because it was, like, loud, and I don't think the conversation would have been great. And so I knew we had, like, a 30-minute car ride home, so I was like,
yeah, okay. That was the time.
Yeah, that was the time. So we got in the car, and so as I'm about to bring it up, my mom, who hasn't said a word about this relationship. She knew about it, but she didn't tell me yes or no or anything like that. She was just very like, nothing about it this whole time for months. And so in the car, she starts talking. And when mom starts talking, it's like about to go down, you know? Mm-hmm. And so she just all randomly just starts going off on the story about the person that paid for our meal, who was a church member of my dad. And so it's kind of common that like, families might immigrate or come over to America, the mom and the kids for education purposes for America.
Yeah,
and
that's
then the dad,
very common.
Dad makes the money in Korea and they'll send over.
Yeah. And same thing in Canada. That was most of the Koreans that were there were moms and kids. Yeah.
And so that was the situation with her. And with the distance, obviously, there was maybe a lot of miscommunication or a lot of different things that happened where ended up in a like separation, divorce with that couple. And the kids were getting older and they didn't, you know, they're on visas. So, you know, you're basically applying to be an international student to go to college. And, but so she needed ways to make money because obviously there's no income coming from the dad anymore. And so she started, I think, a nail salon. And the contractor she hired out was this like white German man that was kind of helping build out the whole thing. And she spent a lot of time there, obviously looking at all the build out, and they spent a lot of time together and like with her broken English. And, you know, they started like falling in love together and they got married. With that, the kids got green cards and citizenship so that they can apply for loans or different things like that to go to college. And it's way cheaper. And I was like, why is she?
Yeah, this is a weird conversation,
story. Mom. Like, why are you bringing this up? And so she just started going off on like, hey, not like just because it's uncomfortable or not, it like,
yeah,
like it doesn't mean it's a bad thing. And they still talk in broken English and different things like that, but they love each other and they know it's, you know, God's will for them to be married. And she said this one thing of, hey, us as parents, we raise you, us as Christian parents, we raise you to obey God. And if you're obeying God, then we shouldn't get in the way of this. And
that's a pretty good feeling there, buddy.
And I was like, okay. And my dad, who's like super extroverted, like he calls himself like this is the first thing he said to Sarah, my wife, actually, when he met her. It's like, I'm the Korean pastor comedian. Like he's the funniest, like he claims himself as the funniest Korean pastor here in Chicago. So he's super extroverted, talks loud, you know. He was dead quiet the rest of the ride. And I think he realized like we did train him to obey God and we shouldn't get in the way of that. And so when he was dropping me off at the airport the next day, he was like, all right, let's make plans for her to come or for you guys to come see us in Thanksgiving and we can meet her and then we can see if,
how long before you asked her to marry you?
After Thanksgiving.
Yeah.
It's probably like, a few weeks after that.
Oh boy.
But it was awesome because then he was the one, he doesn't really text in the family group chat, but he was the first one in the family group chat to be like, hey, Moses is getting engaged at this day.
That's
and
great.
We should pray for him. And so it was a cool redemptive story for us.
It's great. And how long have you been married?
2018. So 6 years.
6 years?
Yep.
And you have a progeny.
A progeny.
Sorry, child.
A child and one on the way.
That's right. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Do we know what you're having?
A boy.
A boy.
Yep.
And you already have?
A boy.
A boy.
Yep.
Look, all these sons.
All these sons. Raising men for the church. Hopefully.
It's the best way of church growth, buddy.
That's right. Having kids.
The natural way.
You know.
So. I do. Now, you're just new here. I need
am.
To fit. You're new to the staff
I
here.
Am.
And you are basically doing a sort of hybrid role here at the Rolling Meadows campus of on the one hand worship and on the other hand executive pastory type stuff.
I guess.
Do you not know that?
Well, I do. Yeah.
Okay.
I was part of a lot of the growth group conversations and different things like that.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Yeah.
So, it all looks different. Executive pastor is a very wide
I know it's a different
of,
word.
Like some people are in finances and
it's
some
what's
people,
needed.
Yeah.
That's what
it's the catch-all.
Mean. You're
the catch-all.
Hey, we need somebody. We'll get Moses to do it. Has it been okay so far?
It's been crazy.
Seriously, nobody listens to it.
There's a guy named Jeff in meetings that have been kind of...
I'm not great in meetings.
I'm joking.
You've been great. Not going to lie.
Yeah. You've been great.
The meeting is not a thing that I wake up in the morning and think to myself, I really want to go and do that.
Yeah, me too.
Yeah. Most meetings are emails. And people know that, right?
Yeah.
Most meetings are emails.
Yep.
I understand the need to sit and look at each other and stuff like that, but
yeah. You should charge people to be in meetings.
I know a guy who actually sets his clock, his alarm to 20 minutes.
Oh, and then he's out of there?
Yeah. Unless it's a necessary conversation at the 20 minute mark.
Maybe we should do that.
He's done. He's like, all right, that's
we're out of here.
Which I was like, that's great.
That is a great idea.
So, Yeah. But you know what? We pastors, we just sit around and look at each other anyway. Yeah. That's the whole point of it. Yeah. You've enjoyed it though.
I have.
Yeah. I've enjoyed having you here.
Oh, thank you.
I have.
Yeah. It's cool just coming from the church plant to somewhat established the church and then kind of left, but it's kind of as we were like seeing kind of it all rebuilt in a way that I've had some experience in that and we
can kind of
speak into it. So it's been awesome.
Yeah. Well,
and I love this church. I always say it's like, obviously a lot of hard things have happened. Mm. And, but when you're in the room, I came and visited in 22 actually. And, on a 4th of July weekend, it was like four people in the band and like, but there was a lot of people there. And, I just felt like, man, these people want to be here.
Yeah, they do.
And, you can't say that about every church.
No.
And they've gone through a lot.
Yeah.
And they want to be here. And as a worship leader, you say like, oh, hey, worship in the valley or worship through the hard times. But when it's like, they've lived that.
They've really had to do it.
And it makes somewhat of my job easier as a worship leader of like, they, you know, whatever the circumstances surround, they're going to worship Jesus.
Yeah.
And so it's been awesome.
It's good.
Yeah.
Well, thanks so much for talking to me, man. There's way more stuff that I know that we weren't unable to get into some of your weird proclivities.
Yeah.
But that's okay. I feel like I understand you just a little bit better.
Good.
I'm hoping it's going to give me the ability to show you more grace, but I cannot guarantee that.
Yeah, especially as a Tottenham fan.
Look, man, there's a certain kind of wisdom and discernment that you need to have in ministry, and Tottenham fans don't have it.
Yeah, I try to keep it away from you. Your son was like, don't tell my dad that you're a Tottenham fan. But I did. It somehow spilled. So.
Yeah, well, it's okay. It'll end soon.
Yeah.
thanks so much, Moses. It was great talking to you. For the rest of you, we'll catch you on the next one.